ArrrrCamp. Can everybody hear me? Yeah? Can everybody understand me? Us. Halfway there then. Right, my name is Heath, Fred Heath. So see what I've done there, James Bond style. You can call me Fred. And I came all the way from Cardiff in sunny Wales in the UK to talk about BDD. Does everybody here know what BDD stands for, what it means? Yeah, no? That's a very good point, actually, yeah. Breakfast-driven development. BDD stands for behavior-driven development. And last time I asked at a conference, someone said it's body dysmorphic disorder, which I suppose is technically true if you're at a medical conference, but not really if you're at a developer conference. I would also have accepted bug-driven development. No, just kidding. That's what I used to do, bug-driven development, and now we just do behavior-driven development, yeah? So we eliminate the bugs, as it is. And basically, I've been practicing BDD now for the last 4 years, give or take. And I'll be honest with you, the first couple of years were a real pain to me, were very frustrating. I used to have to rewrite my features all the time. And I used to have to maintain the features, spend a lot of time and effort, and they used to be brittle, they used to break all the time. So it took me a couple of years just to get BDD right. And eventually now, I think I'm at a stage where I can apply BDD at a project and reap the huge benefits. And that's what I'm really here to talk to you about, is to share the lessons that I've learned and to avoid the mistakes that I've made so we can get BDD right. So basically, I'm here to spread the BDD love out to you. Can you feel it? Can you feel the BDD love? Yeah? Yes. Yeah, it's originally at the first row there. At the back, can you feel the BDD love coming up? That's just the air conditioning. The BDD love hasn't reached you yet. just out of interest, just being curious, how many people here have actually used BDD, do actually use BDD on a daily basis? Can you raise your hands up? Okay, quite a few then, quite a few. And out of you, raise your hands. How many would you say that you're happy with BDD and you feel that you're getting 100% out of it? Can you raise your hands, please? Okay, that's considerably less. And that's natural, actually. BDD takes time to master. It takes time to get it right, and then you learn from your mistakes, and you correct them, and you move on. And to the people who didn't put their hands up, I say, don't give up, don't get frustrated, just persevere, and it will pay off in a huge way in the end. So, let's talk about BDD more. Right, what we'll talk about is, we'll start with a quick introduction to BDD, because quite a lot of you haven't done it or don't know what it is all about. And then we'll start talking about how to do it properly. Where to get started, how to define our actors, how to drive behavior, and how to get our features right. And that's pretty important, getting our features right, because the features are like the basis of a system. If you get your features right, then you're halfway there. Get your features wrong, then everything else will just fall apart further down the line, just a matter of time, really. And I know because I've been there. Okay. Right, we can visualize the development cycle as a kind of a circle, or as I call it, an onion. And in the center of the onion, we have the development team, the developers, us, and we do the software. And in the middle layer of the onion, we have the testing team and the QA team. And on the outer layers, we have the stakeholders. We have our users, system integration. If you're doing Scrum, you have your product owners. And the way it works is a bit like that. The development team makes the software, and they push it out to the testing team. And the testing team say, yeah, that's brilliant, great, and they push it out to the stakeholders, to the users. Right? I can see some people smiling up there. And I think it's not quite right. In real life, that doesn't really happen. That's just a theory. So what really happens is this. We push some software out to the testing team, the QA. QA say, it doesn't behave exactly the way we want it to behave. So I'm going to send it back to us. We correct a particular behavior, and we push it back to the QA team. And they say, yeah, that bit is now working, behaving correctly, but this other bit is not quite right. It doesn't behave the way we want it to. So they send it back to us. So we go back and forth a few times, yeah? We go this testing development loop a few times. And eventually, we get it right. And we push the software out, release the software to the users or the product owner or whoever. And I can hear you thinking, well, what's wrong with that? Surely it works. Surely it produces working software at the end of the day. So what's wrong with that? Well, to answer this question, we have to think about toast. Does everybody here love toast? Toasted bread? Butter? Jam? Yum, yum, yum. Yeah? Okay, hands up if you like toast. Cool, quite a few of us here. I love toast myself, and my wife loves toast. And we have this little ritual. Okay, picture didn't come up, never mind. We have this little ritual between us where every other weekend I make breakfast in bed for my wife. So once I make breakfast in bed, I don't mean actually make the breakfast in bed. I mean breakfast in the kitchen, and I put it on a tray and take it upstairs to the bed, right? And you think with my wife, she's got very high standards. She's got very, very peculiar taste. I mean, she married me, right? Brains and beauty. No, I'm just kidding, of course, I've got no brains at all. So she wants a toast just perfect. Yeah? Not too soft, but not too crisp either. Not too white, not too brown. But it also depends on the bread as well, yeah? Sometimes you have the seeded bread, the one with the seeds in. And with that bread, she doesn't really mind if she gets the bread a bit not well done. But with the standard bread, she wants it like very well done, but not too well done. Do you know what I mean? She was just right, just perfect. So what normally happens, I will make the toast for her. I'll put it in a tray with some scrambled eggs and some butter and jam and what have you. I'll take it upstairs and she'll say, oh, Fred, you burned it again. It's black. So I'll take it downstairs again. I'll get my butter knife out and I'll just go and scrape all the black bits out. I'll take it upstairs again and sometimes she will say, oh, Fred, but you scraped it too hard. And I was like, all gone. So I have to go back in the kitchen and make another toast. And eventually, I get it right, yeah? But I'm thinking, why can't I make the toast perfect the first time? Why can't I just know exactly how my wife likes each particular type of bread so then I can actually get the toast right every single time without having this back and forth all the time? Kitchen, bedroom, back and forth, yeah? So that's, I think, I wonder about the software development as well. Why do we have this back and forth? Why can't we get software right first time? Just like we can get toast right first time if we know exactly what we're trying to achieve. And that's where behavior-driven development comes into play. That's the problem it's trying to address. So if we look at our onion from a BDD point of view, It's slightly different. Yeah. So the first thing you can see is that the teams in a development organization have changed. They've expanded a bit. Yeah, they've stretched out. So now the development team is no longer in the center. It just stretches out in the middle layer. And the testing, the QA team, stretches out into the outer layer as well. And same for the stakeholders. Yeah, they're not just on the outer layer. They come to the middle layer. So they tend to overlap, you know, the roles in the development organization. And that's very important for BDD to work right. You need to have overlapping roles. You can't just be a developer and sit there in the middle and wait for someone else to give you a test to write the code for. You've got to participate. You've got to sit there with the people who write the tests and sit down with them and write with them. And same goes for the stakeholders, the users, or the product owners. They need to actually get involved in writing how they expect the system to behave. And we'll talk more about that in a minute. But first, let's see how BDD works. If you remember the previous slide, the development started from the inside out. So we started developing software at the center, we moved to the middle layer, and then to the outer layer. Behavior-driven development is different. It's an outside-in development. So we start from the stakeholders. We start from the users, the product owners. And we sit down with them, and we write some features. What's a feature? A feature is just a behavior, or a set of behaviors, that we expect from our system. And a feature is written in natural language. What's natural language? Well, to me, it's English. To you, it might be French, or Flemish, or German, or whatever. Yeah? But the whole point of the feature is written in a language that anyone can easily read. And the features are meant to be read by anyone. If you write a feature that cannot be read by your users or your product owners, then it's not a good feature. So, we write our features. Where do we go from there? We start writing some step definitions. What's a step definition? A step definition is just some code that exercises our features. So if, for example, we have a messaging feature, then we would have some code in our step definitions that goes to the messaging UI and fills in a message body and puts in a header and a recipient and sends a message and confirms a message has been sent. Yeah, so it's just a code that exercises the feature. That's all there is. And the final bit in our BDD journey is writing code, of course, yeah? Someone's got to do it. And but we're not just writing random code here. We're writing code specifically so that the step definitions pass. So whatever assertions are made in the step definitions, we should provide some code that enables them to pass. So if, for example, our step definitions, like I said, have a messaging code that goes and sends a message and confirms that the message has been sent, then we write some code that enables this to happen. So what we've done here, we started from the behavior of the system, from the features on one hand, and we've got the code on the other hand, and we bring them together through the step definitions. So the features, the behavior of the code, and the actual code, the system itself, they're tightly bound. The first lesson here, the first lesson that I learned the hard way, was make sure everyone works together. So all the roles in the organization should overlap. So developers work with testers, with the QA, with the product owners, with the users. And that's pretty essential for BDD to work, to get it right. Okay. So what do we bother? What do we do with it? What's in it for us? Well, first of all, you make sure everybody talks the same language. Yeah, we said features should be read by everyone. It should be accessible to anyone. And because everyone talks the same language, then everyone understands exactly how the system should behave. So there's no ambiguity. And of course, our features can serve as documentation. If someone asks you, how does your system behave? Just point up to your feature files. Simple. Now, most of us in the Ruby world use Cucumber, obviously. If you come from a Java world, there's other tools like JBehave. There's Behat for PHP. But they all do the same thing, more or less. You know, they run the code against our features through the step definitions. And they tell us whether our features, our behavior, is what we want it to be or not. So at any point in development, we can actually run Cucumber, and we can see a nice list of greens and reds. And greens are the features at work, the scenarios at work, and red is what doesn't work. Okay? So we have this measurable feedback all the time. And finally, it's a big one, we get considerable bug reduction. When we release the software to the customer, there's a lot less bugs. Why are there a lot less bugs? Well, because we knew exactly what we were building in the first place. So we built it in the way that the customer expected. There was a study done on TDD a few years back from IBM and a few others, if I recall. And they found that using TDD reduces bugs by about 40 to 80% compared to non-TDD approaches. And BDD is just a TDD approach, really, yeah? Use the same principles, red, green, refactor, and test the front. So from my experience, actually, that number would be even greater with BDD, because I've seen considerable reduction in projects that use BDD compared to other approaches. But that's just empirical, that's just me. Okay, so enough about the talk, enough about the theory. Let's start doing something with BDD. And since we are at ArrrrCamp, what better thing to do, really, than build ArrrrCamp? So let's build a website, yeah? Call it ArrrrCamp.com. Okay, and I know there is a website already, but bear with me, just for this afternoon, let's build another one. Okay, and the first thing we do, the first thing I always do when I start a new system, is that I always create a nice big box. And what's in the box is our system, our behavior, our features. And what's outside the box is the things that drive this behavior, the things that determine these features. I'm going to call these things actors. Is everyone here from object-oriented or UML background? Okay, does anybody know what an actor is? And please don't say Brad Pitt. I've heard it before. Yeah, okay, quite a few people there. Well, an actor, traditionally, is someone who acts upon a system or is acted upon by a system. Yeah, that's a traditional definition. For BDD, we need to expand it a little bit, expand the term. And we need to say an actor is someone or something that dictates behavior on our system. Simple as that. Okay, so we have a system. This was in the box up there. We have an ArrrrCamp website. Who do you think your actor should be? Who do you think should interact with the website? Any suggestions? In public, well, you could call it a user if you like. Anyone else? Sorry?
Search.
Search engine, possibly, yeah, okay, that's a possible actor. Okay, what about the administrator, yeah? The guy who maintains the website. So let's write that down. Okay, so we have a user. What's a user? User is a person who sits on the front of the computer in the room and interacts with the website, yeah? With the administrator maintains the website, makes sure it's functioning correctly, keeps the logs and everything. What about the organizers of ArrrrCamp? Don't you think that they want some behavior on the website? Is it fair to say the organizers dictate behavior? Yeah? Of course it is. So let's put the organizer as well. Now let me ask you a question. Say we have a data store where we keep all our data for the ArrrrCamp website. It could be a MySQL database, it could be a Redis store, anything really, it doesn't really matter. Now, do you think the data store should be an actor or not? Okay, hands up if you think it should be an actor. See, I just tricked you there. I just put my hand up. You put your hand up. Hands up if you think it shouldn't be an actor. Okay, that's interesting. Quite a few people say it shouldn't be an actor. The answer is, you're both right. The answer is, it depends. If the data store is within our control, if we created it, we manage it, yeah, if we have root access to it, then it's within our system, it's part of our system, and it shouldn't be an actor. If, however, the data store is someone else's data store, sitting on the cloud somewhere, hosted by someone else, we can only interact with it through an API, then it's external to our system, it's not part of our system anymore, and it dictates behavior. So we should mark it down as an actor. So say, for example, we use GitHub for our ArrrrCamp website. So we can, I don't know, get some code samples for the speakers. Yeah? That GitHub is an actor because we interact with it through an API that's restricted to us that we can't change. So let's put another actor up here and call him an external API. Okay. Right, so we've got our actors. Got our system defined. Where do we go from here? Something doesn't sit right with me, actually, looking at this. Something not quite right. Can anybody guess what's not quite right with that? Sorry? Yeah, that's just me being lazy. what I don't quite like is the user. What's a user? What's a user? A user is someone who uses a system. What does that mean? It doesn't mean much. It's very generic, isn't it? The user system. What do they do with it? Well, the way I see it, someone who goes to the ArrrrCamp website, they can do two things with it. One is someone like, well, most people here, actually, who want to attend the website, or to attend the conference, yeah? And the second bit is someone who wants to speak at the conference, and then maybe wants to submit a talk, or see who else is speaking. So what we can do here, we can actually assign these roles to the generic user actor, and we can say that the user actor is a delegate, and a delegate, we can call it attendee if you like, doesn't really matter, and this is a person who wants to come to the conference, yeah? So they go to the website to find out what it's all about. And we can have a speaker role. A speaker role is someone who wants to speak at the conference, and they want to submit a talk for approval, okay? So what we've done here, we've actually specialized our actors. Yeah, we took a generic user actor and we created two specific actors with specific roles and specific demands from the system. And that's very important because if we don't do that, we can't easily discover behavior. We can't easily write features. Because a user is just too generic. We can think of generic things for a user, but not specific features. And we'll see an example of that in a bit later. We can actually do the same thing with the organizers. Yeah? We can have a salesperson as one of the organizers who might want to, sell some tickets for an event after. And they could put some adverts on the website. We can have a marketing person. Yeah? True story, a couple of years back, marketing director where I used to work made us change all the text on our website because he thought it was a bit formal, a bit rigid, and he wanted to be more cool, more streetwise, and capture a younger audience. And we did it. But that's just an example of someone who's a passive actor dictating behavior. Okay. So, lesson for the day, for now, make sure your actors are specialists. It's very difficult to discover behavior for actors that are generalists. Specialize your actors. Okay. So, we've got a system, we've got our actors, we've got specialist actors. Where do we go from there? Well, the talk is called Feature This, so we need to start writing some features, yeah? And how do we do that? That's very, very easy. This is some Ruby code that does that. So all we do for each actor that we have, for each specialized actor, we ask two questions. We ask them, what do they expect from the system? What does the system expect from them? And that gives us a feature. Okay? Is that a good feature? Is that a valid feature? How do we know? Well, we need to validate the feature. We need to make sure it's solid, it's durable. How do we do that? For every feature, we write a feature story. What's a feature story? A feature story is just a user story, but in a very specific format for that feature. So we say that as a specialized actor, I want a specific system behavior so that I can have a tangible benefit. Okay? What's a tangible benefit? A tangible benefit is a benefit that's measurable, that's observable, that has an effect, has a repercussion. Let me give you an example. Okay. So we talked about our delegate user, yeah? Our attendee. Right, what does the entity want to do with the website? With our website? He wants to go to our camp and see what the talks are, yeah? So we can have a feature and call it conference talk viewer. It doesn't really matter what we call it, as long as it makes sense. And we can say that as a delegate, I want to see a summary of all the talks so they can decide if I like any or not. Okay, is that a valid feature? Let's find out. Okay, as a specialist actor, as a delegate, that's fine. I want some specific system behavior. I want to see a summary of all the talks, yeah? That's specific enough. So that I can see if I like any. Is that a tangible benefit? What does like mean? I mean, how do you rate like? It's very fuzzy, yeah? What's the effect of liking something? I'm not quite sure. So that's not a tangible benefit. So let's rewrite the feature like that. So now we say, as a delegate, I want to see all the talks so that I can decide whether I want to attend the conference. Yeah? That's a massive difference there. Why is it a massive difference? Because now we have a tangible benefit. And the tangible benefit has very specific outcomes. What are the outcomes? Well, one, if I like the talks, I want to attend the conference, what do? I want to book a ticket, really, yeah? Okay? So if I don't like the talks, if I don't want to attend the conference, what I might need to do then? I might want to tell the organizers why I'm not attending. Feedback. Okay? So I might want to say, well, there are no BDD talks, so I won't bother. Okay? So by having a tangible benefit, by having the feature written correctly, we just discovered two more features for that particular actor. Right, this is an example I came across a few months back, actually. And I won't name which company. But it was like that. It was a feature, and it was called menu item highlighting. And all it was, you had a scenario outline. Scenarios outline, by the way, are just scenarios with parameters in them, if you're not aware. So we can pass different values to them. But all it did was just make sure that when you we clicked on the menu, you went to a page, the menu entry was highlighted, and it had a little arrow next to it. Okay? Simple as that. I can see some people blinking. I think it's the young ones here. Okay, let me interject something here. There was a time, and I'm old here, there was a time when not every web page was a single page app. Okay? There was a time when we had things called frames and horrible things and menus on the left-hand side and all this. That's how old I am, right? And that was one of these, actually, yeah? So you had a menu, and you clicked on it, and a little arrow came up next to the menu. The menu was highlighted in some ghastly color. And I looked at this feature, at this scenario, and I wasn't quite happy with it. So I sat down with the guy who wrote it, and I said, well, it doesn't look right to me. I said, can you actually give me a feature story for this? So he tried, and to cut a long story short, he couldn't. And the reason why he couldn't was he was writing his feature story like that. As a user, as a web user, when I navigate to any page by clicking the menu, I want to see the menu highlighted so that I know which page I'm on. And I said, hold on, that doesn't make sense. He wants to see what page I'm on. He wants to know which page he's on. How's that a tangible benefit? I mean, surely the user knows which page they're on because, one, they clicked on the menu link in the first place, and two, they can read what's on the page. So what benefit is it to the web user to have a little arrow on the little highlight? And he said, really what's happening, he said, is that the design director wants all the websites for the company to behave in the same way. And because we have other websites, but when you click on an entry, it highlights a menu, then we must have the same thing happening on our website too. And I said, well, okay, that's fine. That's fair enough. Not a problem. But we need to rewrite the feature, because it's not the right feature. So we rewrote the feature. We wrote it like that. Okay, so now we change the actor. And we said, as a design director, I want the site to be navigated consistently with the other sites so that I can maintain a consistent corporate image. Okay? Is that a tangible benefit? To me? No, don't care. To the web user? Couldn't care less. To the design director? It's hugely tangible benefit. That's the job. That's what they're paid to do. maintain the corporate image, okay? So we wrote it like that, and we left the scenario exactly as it was. And the next day, one of the QA guys came up to me and he said, oh, he said, I saw the feature for the navigation consistency, he said. Now, all our other websites, he said, they've got a little logo on the corner, and if you click on it, it goes back to the homepage. So I think this site should have the same thing, really. I said, okay, that's fine. Can you put the scenario in? So we put the scenario in, so we had two scenarios at this point. Now, on that stage, I actually left this for a bit. I worked on another project for about 2-3 weeks. And then I came back to it about 3 weeks later, and I looked at the feature file, and we had not two, but we had 18 scenarios in there. And the reason for that is because people saw the feature and they came up with other ways that consistency was lacking from our website. So they added the scenarios in. And I was thinking, well, really dodge a bullet here. These are 18 scenarios, these are 18 bugs that would have come up at some point in the future. Because when we released the code, someone would have seen the website and would have said, well, it doesn't behave like the other websites that we have do, raise a bug. So just by having a feature written correctly, we avoided ourselves the effort and the cost of a huge number of bugs. Okay, so the trick here, the tip rather here, and you can't see it because it's embedded in an image, and the image is not shown for some reason, and apologies for that, is that you should always make sure you have your features done right and validate your features against a feature story. Always have a feature story in your feature. Make sure that your feature matches a feature story, okay? Right. So let's go back to our delegate actor. Yes? We have a delegate, a guy who sits on the website and wants to attend ArrrrCamp. And they like the talks and they want to come to the conference. They want to book a ticket, yeah? So we have a feature called ticket booking. And we say, as a delegate, I want to book a ticket so that I can attend the conference. Okay, is that a valid feature? Yes, it is. It matches our feature story template. Okay, so we've got a feature. The thing to do now is write a scenario, okay? And we normally start with a happy day scenario. It's easiest and most frequently encountered scenario. So let's write a scenario here. Okay, and the happy day scenario here is a successful booking, yeah? And given that I go to the booking page, I can enter my name and my email and my surname, and I can click on the OK button, and I get a message saying, hey, you got a ticket. Right. What's wrong with that? Can anybody tell me what's wrong with this scenario? Yeah? Yeah? Yeah, you're both spot on, really. There's actually two things that are wrong with it. One, like you both said, we're talking here about how to do things, how to book a ticket. Now, the actor, yeah, the delegate, doesn't really care about putting his name there and a surname over here and clicking that button. What they want to do, they want to book a ticket, yeah? As a user, as a web user, if I go to any website, not just ArrrrCamp, and I want to book a ticket for a conference or Strictly Come Dancing, I don't particularly care if I go to put my email there and my surname over there and click that button. All I want to do, I want somehow to book a ticket. That's what I care about. And the same goes for the objective, yeah? The message, ticket is reserved, appears. I don't particularly care, as a user, whether I get a message that says, hey, here's your ticket, or whether I get an email with my ticket, or whether I get a homing pigeon tapping on my window with a ticket around his little leg. It doesn't matter to me as long as I get my ticket. That's what matters. Okay? So, what happens then if next week my system architect comes into play and he says, well, listen here, he says, we decided to change the way we book tickets now, and we're going to use Google authentication or Twitter authentication or something like that. What happens to the scenario then? It's useless, yeah? Out of the window, as we'll check it. So this scenario, the way it's written, is not durable. It doesn't last. The second thing that's bad with it, it's not very easy to read, is it? So imagine we had, instead of four fields, imagine we had 10 fields, yeah? We have 10 and I enter line and a click line over there. And what did we say about features? They must be easy to read. And if you've got 10 lines of I enter this detail over there and I click on that button over there, people aren't going to read it. And you need to make sure your features are readable. Okay, so let's rewrite this scenario. And write it like that. Same scenario, given that I enter valid credentials, then I can book a ticket. Simple, easy to read, durable. Okay? Right. So, tip of the day, pretend it's an invisible ink. Okay? Tip of the day is make sure your features describe the what, not the how. The how goes in the steps. So when we write our feature that says, given I enter valid credentials, then I get my ticket, then in the step definitions, we have some code that basically goes to that particular field on the website, enters your surname, enters your password, clicks on OK. Yeah, that's where the how goes in the step definitions. The features are for the what the actor wants, what they expect. And the actor doesn't care about how we do it. He cares about what we do. Okay. So my final point for the day is this. I've got a scenario. And again, it's a real scenario. I came across that some time ago. It's a new card request, and it says, given my account is valid, and my session hasn't expired, then I have the option to request a new card. Now, I look at that, and I think, what the hell does it mean? I think, what's an account? Well, to the person who wrote this, to the product owner, or the user, or the business person, probably a bank account, I would imagine. To me, as a developer, it's a user account. What's a session? Again, a session, to me, is an SMTP session. Or a TCP IP session. To the person who wrote that, it's probably something completely different. It's an application level session, or a chat session or something, okay? The same goes for the card. What's a card? Is it a bank card? Is it a membership card, a loyalty card? And that goes back to the first point we made, and the first point, if you remember, was that everybody works together. You need to work together. If you work together, this kind of ambiguities rise up early, so you can clear this up early. But it doesn't always work, though, because sometimes you get a new person on the team, and he reads that, and he thinks, what the hell is going on? So what I normally do, I normally clear ambiguities in the feature itself. So you always have some space between your feature story and your scenarios, and you can write basically whatever you like. Cucumber doesn't mind. And what I do there, I clarify terms like this. So I say, by account, we mean such and such. By session, we mean TCP IP or SMTP session, or whatever. And the other thing you can do as well, that I try to do now whenever I can, is to have a glossary of terms. Yeah? A table where we have all the terms we use in our features, and we clarify each and every term. So we have a table that has the account and the meaning of the account. And if you host your features on an internet wiki or on a tool, a web tool like Relish, then what you can do, you can actually link your terms to your glossary page. So you can make sure that people can click on a term and they see the definition of that term. Well, it's extremely useful and avoids loads of pitfalls. Okay, so the tip here is basically avoid unambiguous language if you can, and if you can't, then make sure you clarify it. You've got a glossary of terms, or you write something in the feature file itself. Right. So that's the end of my talk for the day, basically. And just to summarize what we've done, with a quick intro to PDD. And we talked about how you start writing your features, how you discover your system, discover your actors, and make sure that you know your actors, because they're the ones who drive your features. And when you write your features, just do it right, get it right. Get a nice feature story, get nice scenarios that describe the what, not the how. That's a summary of basically the tips and tricks that I want to impart today. Everybody works together, very important, very important. Know your system and your actors, and make sure your actors are specialists. You can derive behavior from specialists, you can't do it easily from generalist actors. Then every feature must tell a valid story, and the features are about the what's happening, not the how's happening. How goes in the step definitions, what's in the features. And finally, just make sure you use clear and ambiguous terms. Okay, and that's the end of my talk, really, and I'll spend 5 minutes taking some questions, if there are any.